and gentlemen, and welcome to the Monday, October 3rd meeting of the Pembroke Board of Selectmen. We will begin with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please note that this meeting is being made available to the public through a live video and audio broadcast on Comcast Government Access Channel 15 and is being recorded for broadcast at future dates. Comments made in open session will be recorded. We have two announcements. Arthur?
We have a message from the town clerk, Mary Ann Smith. The special town meeting will be held on October 18th, 2016 at 7 p.m. at the Pembroke High School at 80 Learning Lane. On Wednesday, October 19th, 2016, it's the last day to register to vote for the November 8th presidential election. The town clerk's office will be open until 8 p.m. for that special purpose only. If you have any further questions, please feel free to contact the town clerk's office at 781-709-1403.
Thank you, Arthur. And you have one, Bill.
I do. The Fall Household Hazardous Waste Collection Day will be held on Saturday, October 29th of this year from 9 o'clock in the morning until 1 at the Pembroke Recycling Center located at 158 Albemarle Street. For a complete list, please, of acceptable items, please visit the town's website under Trash and Recycling. Or call the Selectmen's office at 781-709-1408.
Thank you, Bill. We have one scheduled appointment, but it's not until 7:30. So we'll move along with action items here. We have folks here tonight that are involved with the Copperwood Circle project, which is a 40B project off of Birch Street. So would you like to come up front and give us an update on where we are?
Okay.
Could you tell us who you are, please?
Absolutely. Owen Kelly, Copperwood Circle Builders. So a couple weeks ago, we met to discuss using an access off Birch Street to transport material to the site to cut off a good couple miles of travel over Valley Street and Route 53. The board had a couple concerns then. One was to check with the police chief about directing traffic, to which he didn't have concerns about blocking off and making it one-way traffic at that time. Also, there was concern over the bus route schedule. We contacted the transportation office. They gave us the bus route times, but they also were not concerned about shutting down the truck routes when the bus was going through. They were supposed to send a message to Ed. I don't know if she reached out to you.
Not yet.
Okay. we did talk to both of them, and again, we're willing to work with either of them if they change their minds. We did meet on site with conservation again. There was discussion about a park that may eventually go in place there. So, I mean, the ongoing discussion right now is if we were to use that land for access, how we could, how it could end closer to what the town had in mind. So I was stopping by today to see if the board had any comments or questions or any further details that they wanted to talk about.
What Owen is referring to is almost 10 years ago, the Recreation Commission, on the heels of the Birch Street Park being completed, formulated a plan for the rest of the property in conjunction with the Conservation Commission. And we were, and it's basically it would relocate the baseball field to another part of the property owned by the town. It would create a lacrosse field, one football field, and resurrect the basketball court that has been dormant for 15 years or so. And so Owen and the group have, you know, been gracious in talking with the conservation about them you know, helping with the town in formulating that plan and putting together, you know, the overall scheme of things for the spring. And so that's some of the discussion that they've had with that. So, and of course, we, on the heels of one of the meetings that we had, both the police chiefs, the conservation agent, the recreation director, and myself met, and we reviewed the plan that's approximately 10 years old. And that was what was presented to Owen and his associates. So they're continuing to work with conservation on that. And when's your next meeting scheduled with conservation?
So conservation, we probably not next week because it's Columbus Day, the week after. But right now, the biggest input is from the Selectmen's office. If they have, if you guys have any further concerns about moving forward with that access.
I don't have any concerns. I'm ready to make a motion.
I just have one comment. I'm willing to commit to restore any natural woodland that will be degraded because of this process.
So we've been talking to conservation about that. With this park project that's been happening, the goal would be that the town would just to determine what kind of state they wanted to be turned into. So it may end up being that we would clear an area that the town wouldn't then have to clear later. So we'd leave all that to the conservation's jurisdiction, what exactly they'd like us to put back and what they'd like us to leave as it is.
All right.
The only comment I have is on the traffic route and the hours of operation for the trucks.
Yep.
Now, under because this is a 40B project, the Zoning Board of Appeals is the government agency here that would work with you to set the terms and conditions.
Yes.
Now, normally when trucks are moving earth around town, mm-hmm. a permit has to be gained from the Board of Selectmen.
Yes.
We are not involved with that, but I do have, and for the public, I'd like to tell them that the rules that have been established by the Zoning Board of Appeals is that the trucks will roll Monday through Friday from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. So they have set that. And also, I'm a little confused about when do you actually get a building permit issued?
So building permits are established after the drain water, the stormwater systems are in place. Obviously, we need
okay.
access, and we need to make sure
yeah.
that the drain.
So that's a while. That's
correct.
A while.
That's
down
a
the
while.
Road.
We are in discussion with, because there's a lot of fill work going in, we are in discussion with the building departments about obtaining foundation permits only at the beginning to reduce the amount of earth disturbance. So essentially, so we're not putting in the fill and then scooping it back out and then putting a foundation in place. So we're discussing with the building department and with the ZBA
good.
What the town would prefer there.
Okay. The other thing I'd just like to mention for the public, that once a building permit is issued to you for this project, you have agreed to pay the town of Pembroke an amount in of $10,000 to be earmarked for the maintenance and improvement of the Birch Street playground. So that's
correct.
Just for public knowledge. So we're not there yet, but
no, but in lieu okay. of doing an on-site recreation facility, it made more sense to the board to for us to contribute to the park that's right down the road.
Right. Okay, Bill, did you have a motion you wanted to make?
I do. I'd like to make a motion that we approve this project for them to use the shortcut to go through the town on land over onto Birch Street. And, you know, under the auspices that they have all the proper permits and all that, and from what I understand, they do. So.
Okay. Motion by Bill. Is there a second?
I second.
Second by Matthew. Any questions?
I just think that that's a great thing that you're doing, helping out recreation and working with conservation and the other town agencies. It's we appreciate that.
Very good. I'll take a vote now. All in favor of Bill's motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, hearing none, I deem it unanimous. Thank you for coming in.
Appreciate it.
And doing a good job working with the town, and I know we got a long project ahead of us, but...
Hopefully stays this smooth all the way through.
Right, exactly.
Good.
I wish you good luck on that.
Thank you very much.
All right, you're welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks.
We're going to move to the action items, and the first one is, I would like a motion from the board to reopen the special town meeting warrant to insert one additional article.
Move to reopen the special town meeting warrant for inclusion of the article recommended by town council.
Motion by Arthur, is there a second?
Second.
Second by Bill. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, hearing none, unanimous. Now, the article that we want to add was given to us by Copeland and Page, who has reviewed the warrant, all of the articles, as they usually do, to make sure that everything is legal. We had an article that was establishing a special injury leave fund, where we would put money into a special fund that if police officers or firemen were hurt on the job, we could pay what was needed to be paid for their recovery out of this fund, and not have to purchase insurance for this. But so we had an article that was going to do that. But before we do that, we have to see, I'm going to read this, to see if the town will vote to accept the provisions of Chapter 41, Section 111F of the General Laws, inserted by Section 60 of Chapter 218 of the Acts of 2016, which is effective on November 7th, 2016, and establishes a special injury leave indemnity fund for the purpose of establishing and appropriating amounts for the payment of injury leave compensation or medical bills incurred under Chapter 41. So this is a legal issue, but we need to have this article added. So if there are no questions from the board, I'd like to have a motion to add this new article.
I would move the article as read.
Motion by Arthur. Is there a second?
A second.
Second by Matthew. Any other questions? Hearing none, all those in favor of adding this new article to the warrant, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
I will be voting on that because that may affect me sometime in the future.
Okay, Bill is going to abstain, so the vote will be 3 in favor and 1 abstaining. Now, I would like to have a motion to close the special town meeting warrant.
So moved.
Moved by Bill and seconded by Arthur. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, hearing none. I deem it to have passed. We have a one-day special liquor license request for Sun and Ski at 296 Old Oak Street. They are having a special three-day event from October 21st, the 22nd, and the 23rd. It's called First Track Ski Sale, and it will be located in the parking lot where their store is off of Route 139. They hired people to run it and to serve food and samples of liquor, and they have attached their application, and the police department and fire department will be involved in this so that they can add any special requirements. So I'd like to have a discussion or a motion.
I'll move it for the purpose of discussion.
Mr. Chairman? gentleman here to speak.
Yes. Oh, I'm sorry.
Any assistance or answer any questions from the board?
Good, thank you for coming in, appreciate it.
My name's Reed, I'm the general manager over there.
Very good. So is there anything that you'd like to add in what you're looking for us to do for you?
No, we're just hoping to, you know, we're doing a large ski sale event, and while it is obviously sale-focused, we are also trying to make it an event for the community as well, with some food and beverages and things of that sort, as well as partners in our industry, ski mountains and that sort of folk. You know, there's some affinity between the skier community and the beer-drinking community that we were hoping to have some samples of beer available for some of our customers to enjoy it while they are attending the event. Obviously, that will be under very controlled circumstances and with the utmost respect for the town and community. It is certainly planned to be a very family-friendly event, and that will certainly be one of the focuses of the event there. And I would be happy to answer any additional questions or address any concerns from any of the board members.
I have one question.
Sure.
Is this all new skis, or is it...
We generally only sell new product, but we will have skis from this year as well as previous seasons available. A wide variety of product. We have almost soon to be 33 stores in our company, so we take a lot of stock out of the breadth of the company and ship them in for events of this nature. We have two other ongoing events similar to this, one in Long Island and one in Chantilly, Virginia. The Chantilly, Virginia event has 33 years of history there. So it's a, you know, pretty wide breadth of offerings that we'll have available.
The only reason I ask is I'm doing a big clean around my house, and I have four sets of skis that I've been looking to get rid of, so
okay.
I don't know if, if they take in anything like that. But
yeah, we other stores of ours have done like ski swap type events. We have not had something planned quite for that.
Just it's all new stuff, and mostly all new.
Generally, that's as far as our business is selling things.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions?
My concern is we're doing this outside.
Our plan would probably be to have a controlled environment where the beer would be served and consumed, fenced in, and that sort of thing. I'm sorry if I interrupted.
No, that's... I mean, as long as the police chief is happy with it, and, you know, if he assigns a detail to it or whatever, but...
yeah, we're happy to abide by whatever concerns the associated folks would have.
Yeah, I would support it subject to the approval of the police chief.
Second.
Good.
I just have one question.
Sure, certainly.
Do you plan on serving bottles of water at this event?
Yeah, we'll have water available and other food and beverage. We're hoping to have, we're in the process of looking into some food trucks and things like that.
So for the purposes of bottled water, would it be possible for you to store them in the shade while this event is ongoing?
Certainly, probably inside. We have refrigerator available and that sort of thing.
Great. The only reason I bring that up is because BPAs often get released if bottled water is left out in the sun for a prolonged period of time.
Sure.
Thank you.
Good. Good idea. Good idea. Any other questions for this gentleman? Hearing none, do I have a motion?
I would move it subject to the approval of the police chief.
Okay. And so we've added that amendment to your motion about the police chief. Is that okay with you?
Yes.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none? I deem it passed unanimously.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you for coming in.
Our pleasure.
And you'll be working with the police department on all this, and I'm sure other departments in the town also. So
okay.
Wish you good luck on that.
All right, thanks so much.
All right.
Happy to be a part of the community down here, and very much appreciate
it. We're glad to have you.
Thanks so much.
Thank you for coming in.
We were going to have a discussion tonight on Article 17, which is Item D under the Community Preservation Fund request. It's now Article number 18. The legal department has a ruling on that, but the chairman of the CPC committee stopped in earlier tonight, and he is requesting that we vote that article, town meeting floor discussion.
So moved.
So I would recommend that motion by
second.
Second by Arthur. Any questions? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, hearing none, I deem it to be approved. I'm going to go by signing the special town meeting warrant right now because we still have a couple of articles to talk about, and we will sign the warrant when that discussion is over. The next item is a discussion of the open meeting law complaint.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we accept the first letter written by the attorney and support that as being our answer.
Okay, motion by Arthur. Is there a second?
Matthew, do you have a copy of that letter, by the way?
I believe I do.
Second by Bill. Do we have any questions or discussions on that?
Thank you.
I'll give him an opportunity to read those two letters, and then we'll just move on to another thing and vote on it.
Okay, we can do that.
Yeah.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Can do that. We'll put that item on hold for a minute while we read through that. How about voting to accept the minutes of September 12th and September 26th?
I move the minutes of the September 12th meeting as written.
Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Vote, that's unanimous. And September 26th?
I would move the minutes of September 26th as written.
Motion by Arthur. Second by Bill?
Yes.
Sorry, second by Bill. Any questions? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, hearing none. I vote that they've been both approved. Thank you. We could go on to old business. Bill, would you? You have a couple of things, I understand.
Yeah, I do. There's myself and the chairman responded to a meeting in Halifax about a week or so ago, and it was regarding the diversion of water, mostly from Halifax. The Congressman Tom Coulter was there, Representative Cutler was there, Brockton City Council was there, and a lot of other dignitaries and people from around the community of Halifax, and Pembroke was represented by three or four people, including the chairman and myself. I think it's really kind of important that maybe Pembroke also has one of these meetings and ask our representatives and our congressmen to come to the meeting here in Pembroke, and I've been trying to work with the chairman as if we can set that up sometime in the near future. Brockton seems to not want to respond back to letters of concern that we've sent to them about the screens that are broken in the diversion pipe that the juvenile heron can get down into Silver Lake when they do divert water. They're not concerned with repairing one of the gates at the dam. And they're not concerned with taking a lot of water that which leaves Furnace Pond in a very low state. This year, the pond has gone down so much, even Oldham Pond has gone down so much, that there is no water passing between Oldham Pond and Furnace Pond. I've talked to the Division of Marine Fisheries about it. We're kind of hopeful that maybe we'll get some rain and we'll be able to get some water through there. It's just a tragedy that this is the year that we've had the most heron that have come upstream to migrate, and now we can't get them out. There is no water down at the diversion pipe, and there is no water at the dam. on the backside of Furnace Pond. It's probably down about 16, 18 inches. I know that a lot of the ponds have gone down, but these ponds here are a bigger tributary to the fish that that are coming up, and I just don't think that Brockton should take that. They have a right to do it. It's by law they have a right to take the water. But I think when they made that law years ago, I don't think they considered all these factors. And I know that the groups have worked real hard to get the fish come up, and the last couple of years we've had a really big increase in the fish, and now we've had the biggest increase this spring on fish coming up. The usual count comes in anywhere between 20 to 30,000 fish. Last year we had 120 something thousand. This year we had 238,000 fish that came up. And I think a lot of that is contributed to the guys really working hard in the streams and getting things cleaned up so that the fish can come up. The town has spent a lot of money on buying cranberry bogs and land around. They spent a lot of money on the ponds, trying to make the ponds cleaner and safer and swim in and recreation in. And Brockton just doesn't seem to care to help us either monetarily or in any other way, but just to take the water. And I'm not very happy about it. And I know when you look at the ponds down there now, I don't think that the pond would be down as low as it is now hadn't they taken all of the water in the spring. And now that there's a drought on, it's the lowest that I've ever seen it since I've been in town. I've never seen it this low before. And it's just a tragedy that we can't get the fish out. So I would really like to try to schedule a meeting with Brockton, with all of those people, with our representatives, and see if we can't work on something for them not to take the amount of water that they're taking and go to the WMRA or some other place to get their water rather than, you know, sucking it out of Pembroke and Silver Lake and the Montponset Lakes. So there's got to be a halfway point there somewhere that we can do that. So I just wanted to let you know that we're working on that, and we're going to try to see if we can get something going on this so that And I really don't know how we're going to get the fish out of Oldham Pond and a Furnace Pond, because even if we did that, we still can't get them out because there's no water at the height so that we can open a gate and let them out. There's not even enough water to do that. So it's just, in my estimation, just a tragedy to allow that to happen. So hopefully we'll be able to do something about that. The other thing that I wanted to bring up was that October 15th, we're having Employee Appreciation Day, and I would like to work out some type of schedule with the Board of Selectmen so that we can all chip in and help present these certificates to all the employees. So maybe working with the Selectmen and Sabrina and Ed, we can set up. School department has a lot of employees down there, and if we ask everybody to come to Pembroke Center all at once, it's going to be an awful big day passing out certificates to everybody. So I would like to coordinate something that maybe some of the selectmen can split that up and make deliveries and present them to the different departments and stuff throughout the town the week prior to a big event, which is going to be on the 15th. So something that we can talk about either now or in the very near future.
Maybe we could schedule a meeting during the week, during the day, that you would be available and I'd be available. We could meet with Ed and Sabrina and anyone else who could make it, because we're going to be looking for, at a couple of weeks here with no Selectmen's meetings. A holiday next week and then the town meeting. So I think we'll have to do it outside of this meeting.
Okay.
But you and I can get together with Ed and we'll do that.
Yeah, the certificate should be all done this week. It should be printed this week, so.
Okay. Quickly, we have a 7:30 appointment, but we're in the middle of voting on how we're going to answer a complaint on an open meeting law violation. Did you get a chance to read what the attorney said?
I did, and I made a vote.
Okay. So.
We have a motion.
Matthew, I just wanted, for clarification, Arthur's number one is the second conclusion.
Okay.
Okay. Because this was the first letter, and this is the second letter.
Right.
I should have put it in order that Carolyn wrote them, but.
Okay.
So Arthur's motion is to adopt a second conclusion as opposed to the first one that's in your first page.
Right. Yeah, and that version reflects the meeting that we had last week with our attorney and a full discussion on this matter with all the Selectmen contributed in a discussion concerning what the choices would be. So we have a motion on the floor right now by Arthur. Did we have a second? I'd forgotten that.
Bill, second.
Yeah, I'll second that. I didn't. I know Arthur was going to motion, but I didn't hear him.
Yeah, I made it as a in the form of a motion.
Right. So we have a motion by Arthur and a second by Bill. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor of Arthur's motion, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none, I deem it to be unanimous. Well, it is 7:30, and we have some folks from the school committee. Would you like to come up front, please?
Absolutely.
We have an article on this year's town meeting warrant submitted by the school committee, and school committee is represented. You want to say your name for the public?
Sure. It's Mike Tropiano, current chairman of the school committee.
And
gentlemen.
And we have the superintendent of our school system.
Aaron Obie, happy to be
Aaron
here.
Aaron Obie, thank you very much for coming, the both of you.
Thank you for having us. We'd submitted an article for the special town meeting for the purpose of replacing the turf field at the high school. The turf field at the high school is 13 years old. Generally, turf, when this one was built and even now, generally is a 10 to 15 year life cycle, so we're pretty much smack dab in the middle of that. We've been fortunate over the years to have a tremendous amount of school use, but also community use. If you go up there on a Saturday in the fall, you're going to see youth football. If you go up there Saturday in the spring, you're going to see lacrosse and soccer. So we get a significant amount of use out of that, as well as throughout all of our sports teams, and even the track, which is part of the article that we had submitted. At this point, we're actually going to ask to withdraw that article and to bring it forward in the spring. We're in the process of determining the best way to fund it. We're trying to look at all of our self-funding options just for several reasons. Number one, first and foremost, is we understand the town's financial condition. The town's been extremely generous to the school department, and we want to do what we can before we bring it to town meeting. We had thought we could have all of those ducks in a row now, but we decided that we need a little bit more time to do research on getting firmer estimates on it, as well as look at our funding options in order to make sure it's the most economical for the town. We would most likely want to put it on the special rather than on the annual. The reason for that is that would give us about an extra 3 weeks or so to work on the field prior to the summer. If we went on the annual, the funds wouldn't be available to the 1st of July, which means we couldn't do work until then. And that would make it a tight window for when we start up with fall sports. Starts now a little bit earlier in football. So we're starting mid-August versus the traditional end of August, almost Labor Day that it used to be. And that would give us enough time should we be successful with the warrant article, as well as identifying the funding options. And we want to make sure that the kids you know, are ready to play on it. We don't want to be one of those programs that has to have your first month away or your whole fall season away because you don't have a field. So I'll take any questions there are about the condition or...
I happen to see in this Sunday's paper, I believe it was West Bridgewater, is doing the same thing. But it didn't give any information as to what it was costing them or any other type of information. I was very interested in seeing that, but I didn't really get anything out of it.
Sure. You're starting to see the first wave of replacement fields coming because when we bought, when we renovated the high school, and this was part of the project, turf was being, you know, being put in pretty much everywhere because turf over the life, over this 13 years, is cheaper than grass. So generally, because in our case, we're also looking at doing some track work. We've had a very successful track program since the inception of the high school. They've won state championships. They've had several state champions at the individual level. So we get a lot of use. Our track team in the winter for indoor, it roughly is somewhere between 100 to 120 athletes. So we get a lot of use there. So we would be looking at both. And generally, those projects can range anywhere between $900,000 and $1 million. A lot of money. But when you look at over the life, again, over the 13 years, when you offset it versus the cost of mowing, fertilizing, a facility like that, plus the addition of irrigation.
And we don't have any water to begin with.
I just heard. But you know, when the grass fields generally are tend to be more expensive than the turf fields, which is why we're going that way, because the turf alone is about half that cost, and then when you expand it out to the track, and we've had instances where the track is starting to actually, I guess, I don't want to say break up a cut, or we've had to patch in some places. So when you look at the turf, it's about half the cost, and the track is the other half.
So our current turf field is 13 years old?
13 years old. We're going through our 13th season there with this fall. So the plan right now is to get the fall and spring. If you've been up there, the carpet is in a little bit rough shape. It's had to be sewed several times. We do own our own brush to brush the field because those fields, what they do is when they're put down, there's rubber pellets put on top of it in order to keep the turf down as well as, I guess, make it a little bit softer, easier to play on. And we brushed it continuously and done probably a little bit more than the maintenance required in order to get this much time out of it based on our use.
Anybody have questions?
Mike, there was talk at one time, and I don't remember exactly how it went, but there was some talk of, you know, having the artificial field and having it paid for by people who were using it, you know, renting it and running MIAA events and that kind of thing. Is that in place or is that just...
It is. So we have had some rental usage of the turf over the years, and that's sitting in a revolving account. There's not a tremendous amount of money in that account, and we would be looking to potentially use some of our own athletic revolving to pay mm-hmm. for it. One of the problems we've had with rental is not enough usage time. Given the limited time you have, even with the lights available for usage, we've chosen and give priority to our local teams. So the Pembroke Youth Sports Organizations take a lot of the hours that we normally would be renting out to clubs on Sunday. You know, a lot of club soccer teams would be looking for fields, and you know, we're using at that point with in the springtime, we're using youth lacrosse at that point. So we're very limited in the amount of rentals we can do on it. We've done some, but not a significant amount. I think when the community is ultimately funding it, our preference would be to allow the community to use.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. We try to partner with the sports in order to help us maintain the facilities as well.
So your plan again for this article, are you going to withdraw it?
Or? We'd like to withdraw it. We'd like to withdraw it and then bring it forward to the special in the spring. What we will do is like to get on your agenda, most likely in January, knowing the warrant will open enclosed fairly quickly in February, I'm assuming, and based upon that, we want to get ahead of the curve, have those discussions with you folks, advisory, explain what our plan is, make sure it's fully vetted, and then bring that to the townspeople in that April town meeting.
So you'll be looking at financing?
Yes.
Issues and?
Yes.
Timeframes?
Exactly. Yeah, what we would do is want to do something in less than the useful life of the field. So assuming, you know, looking, we've got 13 years out of this, anything we did would be less than 13 years, so that, again, you know, if you go on a 13 to 15 year cycle, we would want to make sure that we weren't overlapping with any type of pain. That's what we've been looking at.
Yeah, you'd have to factor in when the town meeting that would vote on a replacement, so you may,
correct,
you may be looking at 10 years or 11 years,
absolutely,
something like that.
Yeah, so I think that's what we're looking at is the number we floated about is about 10 years. That we think that gives us the most flexibility long term.
Right.
Again, we're looking at all of our options in order to bring forth the most economically suitable option for the town.
Okay. We have a couple of folks here in the audience. Did you have issues with this particular item? Would you like to ask any questions?
I have a list about that long, but I don't want to take up all the time. Is this going to be every 13 years we have to do another $1 million for a field?
Well, you don't know what the cost is going to be in the future, but this is the field and the track. So we're looking right now at both because of the wear that we've had on the track. It's just the field would be about half that amount. And then what we would do is obviously, you know, we try to maintain it as much as we can in order to get as long of a life as we can out of it.
And I don't understand all the terminology that the board uses. But is this going to go up? If you put the budget for the townspeople to vote on, and the taxpayer funded?
Yeah, so what we would do is have a warrant article in the spring special town meeting for the town people to vote on at town meeting, and then what we would do is come with a financing option to figure out where it would come out of our budget or an alternate funding source.
Because I still have a very bad taste in my mouth 2 years ago what the school committee did to us, retirees especially, and they attacked us. The vote that day, and I sat around all these school teachers, and when you got the big pay raise, and I got the big tax increase, they cheered like little school kids, and I'm still upset about that. It's a very low-class thing the teachers did, and I'm afraid they're going to do the same thing in the spring. They're going to get their word out amongst themselves to say, if we get there, we can pack the hall, and we'll get the vote for it. And what you did last time was, we voted on a Tuesday, and the vote went to the people on a Saturday, and I had maybe been saying, what vote? What's going on? And the override passed. To me, that the whole thing smelled bad. It was a rotten thing to do, and I'm still angry over it.
I know with the timing of the election, what they did is they put it, you know, we worked with a lot of the other town agencies because we couldn't put it on the ballot ourselves, worked the town clerk, the selectmen. The purpose of having the vote then is that was the time of the annual election, and rather than expend additional funds later, they knew the article was coming, put it on the town meeting ballot, and then have a conditional. If the vote did not pass the town meeting, then clearly you wouldn't have the ballot question, but it was to save money from having another election. That was the purpose of the timing of that. It was not done intentionally to try to, you know, pull something over on anybody or try to be disingenuous. It was intended to try and save money by having the two elections together rather than having a separate.
Now in Pembroke, our biggest part of our expenditures is the school budget. Mm-hmm. Over half of our tax money goes to schools. Isn't there a way in the school budget you could fund this yourself?
That's what we're looking at.
That's what I want to get.
Which is why we don't want to bring anything in the fall because we haven't gone through all the auctions, and in order for us to do that we needed a little bit more time, so that's why we've opted to withdraw it from the fall and put it on in the spring.
I'd be comfortable with that if you could do that.
That's
there's an awful lot of our seniors. I've been here 48 years and my income is not growing anymore. I'm retired, And every time I just got the tax bill, the quarterly bill, and it used to be, you know, like $900 a year or so ago. Now it's close to $1,200. And it's the schools. All you hear about is the schools. I know we have good schools. My kids went here. My grandchildren are going here. But the fact is, how much is enough? I mean, football fields shouldn't be on a priority list. That kind of money could be spent on things like feeding some homeless here, and the oil bills for people who can't pay, and the real bad seniors that are really hurting. So the school committee would do us all a favor if they found a way to fund this in-house with the school budget.
I think that's fair, and that's what we've been trying to do. And again, we've been talking about this for a long time. We knew it would be coming up at some point, and now is the time. So what we're trying to do is figure out what our best funding option is, rather than have it come out of the standard general revenues of the town, right, is to see what we could do through our budget to make it the most affordable, but then also provide that the field and track that does get used a tremendous lot, not just by the youth, but there's also, you go up there on a weekend, there are people who are walking the track, or running on the track. I generally walk myself, but that's a different story. It does get a lot of community usage, which is why we're trying to maintain the space.
Is the track cinder? I've never been on the field. Is
it? No, it's a rubber material. It's rubber material. That's traditionally what they use for high school or college tracks. So we have what I would say, they did it with a medium grade, and we'll probably do the same. You get a little bit more usage out of a better grade, but unfortunately the cost is significantly more. So we're trying to figure out what that balance is to what's going to be usable, what's going to give us the best use for the purpose, but also the best on the life of the track. So what would be the, when you look at the cost benefit and, try to figure out what's going to be the best.
I hope this gets publicized for the general population to see that this is going to be an ongoing every 13 to 15 years, and you're talking $1 million?
Million three,
whatever?
No, it's not, it would be somewhere around $1 million. I would say definitely not $1.3 million. For what we'd be looking for, the early prices we got were between $900 and $1 million. And that is, again, for the track and the turf. If it was the turf alone, then it would be about half that, depending upon any type of additional work they had to do on the site. Because those generally to replace the turf can go as low as $400, $450, or could go up to $500 if they pull up the carpet and they find something else. When we inherited that property from Silver Lake and they originally did the turf, they found that was the burying ground for all the stumps when they cleared the land. So what they had to do is the building committee, I don't know if any of the selectmen were running the building committee at that point, I think you might have been here, they actually had to spend extra money to remove all the stumps. Because over time, the stumps would have come up and actually ripped through the carpet,
right,
which would have been a bigger problem for us. So we found that little gem as they were uncovering the earth around the old track from the Silver Lake days, which was, I believe, asphalt.
It just seems that's a lot of money when it could be used for special needs students. It could be used for so many more important things than sports. I mean, sports are great when you got plenty of money and you can afford that extra. But when you're teaching kids, they need to be taught not how to run the fastest quarter mile or whatever. They need to be taught how to read and write properly.
Which clearly, obviously, we set a high priority to. But when you, so for this good size of our population, we have over 60% of our students participate in an athletic, and we have much higher than that. I'm close to 80% participate in an extracurricular. The reason why is there's a level of engagement with the school, and it really hits the social emotional part of the child, where if they don't have that activity to do, whether it be a sport, whether it be a club, to do after school, they're either not feeling part of the community, or they're going, in some cases, home to an empty house. And we're trying to make sure that those children are learning other things outside the classroom. Sports is a great way, not only on the fitness piece of it, but also you develop the teamwork, the understanding about working as a different type of unit within the community, whether it be just a team winning, losing. Those are the types of things that our students are definitely getting out of the sports that they wouldn't get out of the class.
Do they still charge the parents for students for being in sports?
So yeah, there is a user fee for participating in sports. It covers about quarter less than our total budget. So we're still using about between $500,000 and $600,000 a year we invest in sports, and the user fee generates about a quarter of that, which helps pay for that. That was implemented, unfortunately, a long time ago. We got our first tax cuts back in about 2003 or 2004, and we got about $1 million cut in our state aid. We ended up implementing a user fee for sports. So we look at that every year, and we benchmark it against other communities, and we do everything we can to lower it as much as possible, or keep it as low, I should say. And we definitely are one of the lowest in the areas, where a lot of communities have gone to a couple of different things. Either they've done things like remove family caps, or they've gone to per sport charges. So if you play one sport, you pay this, two sports, mm-hmm. you pay that. You play hockey, you pay
you get
more.
Healthy discounts if you have more than one student?
We do a discount. We have a family cap. Yeah,
I thought I had that.
Yeah, other communities have opted not to, and they've raised it where, I don't have the numbers in front of me. We look at every year at the budget. There are local communities that don't put family caps where you could be paying between $500 and $800 for one student to play, depending on what they're paying. We've opted to do is keep it as low as we could and put a family cap so that if you have two students in, you know, you're going to bump up against it. Because we realize when we have our fee discussion, whether it's that fee or anything else we charge, we realize that the fee is just really a thinly veiled tax. So we've, over the past several years, we've pretty much held the line as far as what we've charged. There's a couple things we have to. Full-day kindergarten, we're required by law to put it at a certain level. But the other fees we've kept pretty close to no increases for a few years now. In fact, I don't remember what year we rescinded the elementary bus fee.
6 years.
6 years, was that one? Plus. So 6 years ago, we added an elementary bus fee for students inside of 2 miles because we're not obligated to transport them. Understanding that most of our elementary schools aren't walkable, and most of our elementary schools are the youngest students, we rescinded that fee to make it, again, trying to take that away from the families.
I understand that. One more question about the financing. This million, whatever, how is that going to get spread around? Is it going to be over a 10-year?
That's what we're looking at. We're trying to look at what's going to be, again, whether it be interest rates, whether it be something leasing. We haven't finalized it, and we're trying to. We have to figure out what's going to be the cheapest, and the most economical, and what we could fit within the constraints of our budget. So, I think, you know, early read is it'll be probably some type of 10-year borrowing, but I don't think we know for certain until we look to see what all the options are. We're not going to do something that's. Especially this committee that I've been on, and this group has been together for a while.
I'm going to ask him if he's going to town meeting.
Would not do something
and
that isn't
up in
fiscally drawer. Conservative. I think that's definitely safe to say with the group we have, which is one of the reasons why we're not coming forward with this article and we're withdrawing, because we don't have all of the information in a form that we think we're comfortable with, so we wouldn't ask the taxpayers. The townspeople to vote on that. Not until we're comfortable would we bring something forward.
I just hope that it gets out to the news media so the general public can know, because it's kind of embarrassing. You talk to your neighbor and they go, "What? Never heard of it. Never heard of it. You never know what they're going to do." And that was wrong. Thank you.
Well, I thank you for your questions, but for the record, would you give us your name?
Oh, I'm sorry. Peter Ness, I live on Plutum Road. And I've had my children and my grandchildren, most of them all go from the school.
Thank you.
Does it make any sense to look at going 1 year with the turf and move the track out to a second year?
We've talked about that.
I mean, logistically, I don't know how it works.
So that's one of the things we're looking at. So, you know, and I'll kind of So, a few things on this. So, we are definitely looking to at what the cost of grass would be, because we want to make sure that the benchmark we had previously holds true. Clearly, there has to be something there because other people aren't replacing turf fields with grass. So that's the first thing, you know, I think we want to make clear. We're looking at all
options. Yeah, the MIAA can probably give you figures on that, too.
I'm sure they can, because they know who has what, because they know it for the use of facilities. But the, to get to your question, sorry, is we have looked at and we've talked about it. There's benefit, because once you bring up the one surface, the turf, which is more, which is the bigger issue right now, of the two, once you bring it up, there's value to replacing the track around it, so you're not coming in at the same, you know, at a different time, right? There's I hate to say it, but the synergy to doing both at once rather than separating them. So we'll look at it to see what the cost differential is, but I have a feeling once we get in there, we're going to want to take up both surfaces at once, put them both down at the same time to have the workers in there once. But we are going to look at all options. That's what, again, that's why we're not bringing it now and want to withdraw it. It's not because, you know, anything other than we just don't have all the information that we feel comfortable with in order to bring it forward to the town.
Well, I appreciate your efforts.
So I appreciate the time. And do appreciate the question.
Thank you.
We have another gentleman here. I don't know whether he has any comments he'd like to make.
Not really. This is his seemingly very high expense for doing this. I mean, you come up with $600,000 for the field and $600,000 for the track. Where do you get these numbers from? Presumably you've got some sort of committee or expert doing a check on this to find out what it costs to relay out an existing track, to build a brand new one, tree stumps and all.
We do. We've had people come in to give us high-level estimates on it.
May I ask how many people?
Well, when we go to bid, it'll be an open bid, so it'll be open to everyone. This is not something where we could go to one vendor and select, hey, we like, you know, we like Arthur Boyle's Turf Company and go to him.
Oh, he's pretty good.
He's not bad. I trust him with my kids, so I guess I trust him with them. But it's one of these things where once we go through the process and we will have people look at it for us, clearly they want to look at it and give us a price because it gives them a little bit more information when they go to bid for it. But then when it comes down to the bid, it's sealed bid and it's judged by Mass General laws on who we can take and who we can't, just like any other type of project. So
it just seemed a very large sum of money, that's all.
I do have a question again. On the track section of it, I mean, I'm going back to high school many years ago.
It's changed a little bit.
But the charcoal, whatever they use around it then, is that dangerous to run on? Is that why they don't use it?
There's no loose charcoal. It's all fixed down. It's rubber paint.
No, I don't mean today. I mean many, many years ago. Dedham High School, remember though? They had a field, and I don't remember it being any kind of rubber. It was always something that was shovel it on and spread it out.
I'm pretty sure the old track at Silver Lake, I'm sure somebody would correct me if I'm wrong, I thought the old track that we had at that facility was asphalt. It comes down to, if you think about running on asphalt versus running on a rubber surface, which has a little bit of give or play to it. Also, if you happen to fall, I'm sure you're much rather fall on this than you would on asphalt. So I think it just changes with technology.
It's possible.
Thank you. Would you give us your name for the record?
I could indeed. Nigel Harling, Valley Street.
Thank you. Thank you both for your questions. On this article again, Mike, are you going? We're going to have to vote on this. Should we put town meeting floor?
You could. We're going to vote to withdraw. We're going to ask to withdraw it. We're going up to advisory after this.
Okay.
I'm assuming that obviously the warrant has been printed or close to printed, so we would have to move to withdraw it at that point.
You could vote indefinite postponement.
If that happens, would we be able to bring it in the spring?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
I just want to make sure we're...
Yeah, whatever advisory wants to do to be fine with
We'll ask them. We'll bring
Would we be stepping ahead if we were to reopen the special town meeting warrant, withdraw it, and then close the warrant?
You can do that.
We'll ask upstairs what they want. We have an appointment with them also. And we'll do whatever's easiest for everyone.
Okay.
I think we're pretty...
Well, thanks for coming, the both of you folks coming and giving us all this information.
Yep, and we'll obviously want to get on your agenda again.
Absolutely.
After the first of the year.
Right. Thanks, Mike.
Thanks, Aaron. Thanks, Mike. Thanks, Aaron.
Okay, we have two articles. And one of them we just heard from, so we know what we're going to do with that. We'll wait and talk with advisory. Article 17 allows the town to set the salaries and wages of town employees that are not employed under the conditions of a collective bargaining agreement are employed by the school committee. It's generally the vehicle used to grant cost of living increases and may be amended from time to town. So do we have a recommendation?
Mr. Chairman, do they now make that Article 18?
There has been several changes to the numbers here, Bill, and...
Yeah, the first one that you did...
I think you're right.
All right, on the first one, when you discuss Recommendation D, that's for Article 18. What you're doing right now is you're voting on Articles 16 and 17. 16 is the turf field article.
Right.
17 is the reclassification of those positions.
Okay. Well, we have a motion by Bill on Article 17 for town meeting floor. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by Arthur. Any questions? All in favor, please say aye.
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 Town meeting floor for Article 17.
Do you want a motion on the track and the field for indefinite postponement? Because they're not going to be back in time to...
Yeah, that's true. We are. We'd like to...
Town meeting floor. I'll let them just stand up.
Yeah, town meeting floor, wouldn't that allow them some flexibility to just stand up and say we'll withdraw this article?
Okay,
so you have a issue with that, Arthur?
No, that's fine.
That's okay. Motion by Bill, is there a second?
Second.
Second by Arthur for town meeting floor for Article 16. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, hearing none, so voted. The town administrator's report.
Just a quick update on the revenue subcommittee that was formed by the Selectmen a month or so ago. Basically, at their last meeting, they came up with a list of five things that they want to, that they are considering, and they would like the board to be apprised of the of where the committee is right now. And these five things are: number one, the possibility of champion hotel development in the town, either through a tax increment financing plan or some rezoning issues, basically in North Pembroke. Development of the Washington Street properties, the 17 acres down on Washington Street, which is under the care and custody of the school committee right now, and of course the parcel across the street from the Benson property that was purchased for public safety purposes. Looking at the land that could be developed for new solar projects. Looking at the further development of the downtown based on one of the plans that was submitted by a graduate student at the University of Maryland a couple of years ago at the library, and to look at the mixed-use development in the community center area. And then number five was Matthew's claim to fame on the naming rights for the various fields and buildings in town. So that's a short list of five things that the Revenue Committee has been working on, and Mr. Tropiano and Mr. Chilcott wanted me to pass that along to the board at this juncture.
Oh, that's great news. Anybody have any questions for Ed? Thank you, Ed. Do we have any issues under Ask the Selectmen? Hearing none, I'll move on to new business. Anyone have any new business? Hearing none, I'll go to upcoming issues. October 4th, the special town meeting will be posted. We have a 14-day statutory requirement. So we're under the gun on that, and we're finishing that up tonight. October 18th at 7 p.m. Don't forget, that's the date of the special town meeting where we'll be taking up these articles. Do we have a need for executive session, Mr. Fogg?
One more item under board action, that would be to vote to sign the warrant for the special town meeting.
That's correct. You're right.
I move that we sign the warrant for the special town meeting.
Second. Motion by Arthur, second by Bill. Any questions? All in favor of that motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Hearing none. We will be signing that warrant. Thank you. Executive session, Mr. Thorne. We have item 2, 16, and you want to add 3, I understand.
Actually, we don't need number 2, so Article 7 and Article 7 as written, and then also reasons for convening, that would be number 3. And there'd be a short 5 minute. So if...
Okay. I would move we enter executive session for the purposes of number 3, collective bargaining with union personnel, and number 7, to comply with our act under the authority of Mass General Law, Chapter 41, Section 111F, specifically the police department.
Second.
Motion by Arthur, second by Bill.
Actually, the fire department.
Oh, it says police on our...
I'm sorry.
It says police here, too. That's a police officer.
Oh, for 111F.
Yeah.
For number 3, that would be the fire, right. Fire unit.
Right.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, we said that, the collective bargaining unit.
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions?
And before we do that, Mr. Chairman, I just want to give the opportunity. Does anybody who came here tonight have anything to say to the selectmen? Did you want to make any comments to select them? Was there a reason you came in?
I got a question that I'd like to. Is there any update on the Pleasant Street streetlight intersection change since the last time I came in here? They were talking.
They got out to bid in the spring of 2017.
Putting out the bid in the spring of 2017, and then they want what, another year to do the job here?
It just depends on who bids on the project, but it's 100% designed already. So the Old Colony Planning Council has scheduled it for April of 2017.
Another thing about the fish, the heron, are they all going to die because they're trapped in that pond?
I don't think that they're all going to die, but that's their cycle. When they're juveniles, they go out. The adults come up in the spring and they spawn in the Furnace Pond and Alden Pond. And this year we had some very large fish come up, which I don't think we're able to get up, prior years. So they're currently now, if you go down there at sunset or close to sunset, you can actually see a lot of fish activity in the ponds down there, Furnace Pond and Holden Pond. And,
what's the problem? They all start to age, the aging process, and then they all start dying.
Right. The other thing is that where the water is down so low, if we get a really bad winter and a freeze, now you're talking about a pond freezing, so they can't get out of there and get to where they need to go. So we're really hoping that we can find some way to get them out there.
So they be netted, scooped, and transported?
There's a couple ideas that people have come up with already that we're talking about. One would be to put some type of a border near the brook and pump water from Furnace Pond up into Oldham to carry the fish through.
Get them through.
To get them through into Furnace, but then we have the problem going from Furnace Pond into the brook, which I don't know whether we would have to dig it out or maybe get something in there so that we could make at least one path for them to get out. But they usually migrate by noise and all that, so if there's no water running and they don't hear it, then they're not directed to it. So it's usually the noise of the water running and the going over the falls and stuff like that that they hear. I think if we're able to get them to the other side of the dam off of Center Street, then we've walked that whole area within the last week, and we think that we can have enough water. And we've been holding water back in other areas so that we can open those gates up and allow more water in the streams when we need it, you know, to make that diversion go through okay. But the problem is Oldham and Furnace right now. So, and the Division of Marine Fisheries has been contacted about it. They're also going to look for different ways that they, you know, that they may be able to do that. So it makes sense to me if they had some type of a pump and pumped the water from Furnace into Oldham, that would generate water that's going to come right back into Furnace, so you're not getting rid of it. Then it would just be getting them from there to the other side of the other dam.
It'd be a shame to lose hundreds of thousands of fish. It would be a shame.
Right. I mean, it's taken a lot of work and effort to get these fish up, and we got them up, and now we don't have the water to get them down. So it's we're working on it every day, trying to, you know, figure out what we can do to get them down. So hopefully we'll be able to do that. Maybe this hurricane that's coming up, we can get some rain out of it.
Chapter 90 money.
Hold on a second. Let me check this out. But it's, it's down pretty low, lowest I've ever seen.
Yeah, you guys.
And then you have the fact that we want to use the water also to clean Furnace Pond. So there's a project underway now, and the engineers are designing the project now to use the water to pump all of the silt and the sediment that's in the bottom of Furnace Pond. So we're going to need the water for that also. Which there isn't any right now, so so it's stuck in the middle here.
Your answers. I've asked enough questions.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Well, appreciate it. So.
Yeah, I appreciate your coming.
Thank you.
We're going to go. Sorry, yes, I'm sorry. Yes.
I think I've met most of you, but my name is Shannon Gallagher, and for the time being, anyway, I'll be filling in for Mark Burridge, reporting for the Pembroke paper. Just about. Presumably, there's another 15 articles, 1 through 15. Is that, true?
1 through 17, isn't it?
So there's, I was just going to
ask. Well, it's 1 through 18 now, and if you get rid of the field articles,
that is
17.
And those have all been voted on already?
Yes.
Yes.
And are they, like, publicly available ahead of time for the meeting? Or
no? Yes, they will be. We have to have them available 14 days before town meeting, so that's right around the corner. So
we're
in a hurry to get this done. So when it is done, there will be when it comes back from the printer, we will have copies in the lobby right out here on the table for anybody to come in and get. So we'd like to have people have these before the town meeting. And as you may know, you may not know. If you don't have one, when you go to town meeting, they will have them there. But it's better to have them beforehand. So, well, welcome, and I hope to see you every time we have a meeting.
I think you will be.
All right. Yeah. Good. Thank you. Speaking of that, we are going into executive session, and we have no plans to return into public session.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I believe we have one more question.
Being somewhat naive about this relationship we have with Broxham, Silver Lake, we own that, it's in our hand, it's our territory. Can can we tackle that water?
It actually lies in five towns, and it's under an 1800s law that was signed in allowing Brockton to basically take 1 million gallons a day or thereabouts. And they also supply the water to Whitman with that. So that's part of the problem as well. So it's a lot more complicated than you could get into in 5 minutes, but it's...
The congressman, Coulter, had said that they're trying to work with Brockton. And when the law was made, it was made by the legislature. And if Brockton doesn't decide that they're going to work with us, then he's going to submit a bill after the first of the year to bring that article back up, because the only ones that can change that is the legislature also. So if the legislator made it, the legislator can take it away.
Understood.
So we actually have a meeting in the State House. It's either next week or the week after, and I plan on attending that also. You know, to let them know that we're serious down here about keeping our water here. So,
what would be the deadline for the fish? When is it too late to worry about trying to save them? November?
Well, it depends how much water is left, and whether we have a bad winter. Last year we had a very mild winter, and we really didn't have very much ice on the pond. So the migration of the fish actually was going on right up until the end of December and the first week in January. And then they stayed over until the spring, and then went out in the spring. So we had some fish. We had some fish leaving in the spring and some coming in at the same time. So there's been a lot of fish in the last couple of years, so, which is really good. So.
Yeah, to Bill's point with the lack of water, I live on Little Sandy as an example, and we've got about 30 feet of beach in front of the house where normally the wall is measured at 2.5 feet or so. So we're down a good 3.5 feet of surface water in the ponds, and there's nobody drawing off of us. We're only going down with the aquifer, as it appears.
Right, so Brockton Abington is taking water now, and they draw theirs down. That's going to draw from Furnace Pond. If Silver Lake is down like 12 feet or something, then that's going to draw from other aquifer from around the area. So it makes a big difference if we have a control level to stay there. And one of the things that I asked for them to do is to give us a datum of where our pond should be. Because currently, right now, the only ones that know that is Brockton. And they can tell you how much water they take and where it is, where that level is. But we don't know that. And that's something I think that we should know. If it's coming out of our town, we should know about that. And they talk about taking water, and they have the right as an act to take it out of Furnace Pond, but Oldham Pond is a contributory to Furnace. So they're actually taken out of both ponds. And Abington Rockland Water Supply is right there next to Furnace, which they take it. So if they're drawing Big Sandy down, then the water's going to go over to them also.
Sure.
So it's I'd like to see that change a little bit so that it stays at a good level, which would be good for the fish.
It's been a good balancing job done in Pembroke anyway by the DPW and you know, by people conserving water and not washing their cars in the driveway and not, you know, watering their grass and that kind of thing. It's really been a good effort by the community.
It's sort of amazing. We never had a water ban. I heard about anyways.
Well,
I mean, no signs posted, were they, that I missed? No.
I don't believe so.
No. All my neighbors' yards were all brown and burnt, so I knew they were honoring this current conservation. So we all had dead lawns, so that was a good sign as far as water.
Yeah, I'm a long way back from
we're coming back.
Brown lawn, that's for sure.
Yeah. That one I can't sign.
Okay.
Thanks
for coming in.
Well, my final announcement here before we go into executive session is there will be no meeting of the Board of Selectmen on Monday, October 10th, in observance of Columbus Day. The next regularly scheduled meeting would be on Monday, October 17th, but the next night is town meeting. So we're not sure about October 17th. We may meet prior to the town meeting on Tuesday, the 18th. But check the agendas on the town website. Thank you for watching, and good night.